Hey guys, welcome to Sugar Busters. I'm Richard Wolf, and tonight we're going to learn about how strength training keeps your blood sugar healthy. But before we do that, we've got to answer a couple questions. The first one is, what is healthy blood sugar? What is the cut point for healthy blood sugar medically? The other question is, why should we worry about this? Why should we be concerned about high blood sugar? What's the downside to that? So let's circle back to question number one. What is considered healthy blood sugar? For our conversation tonight, we're going to define healthy as avoiding type 2 diabetes. And so the values for that would be at or below 125 milligrams of glucose per deciliter of blood. Now that's a fasting value. That's a 12-hour fast. And don't get bogged down by those values and units of measurement. Your doctor can do this very easily. Any medical clinic can do it. But if we were to say we tested your blood glucose and we measured it after 12 hours and you're between 100 to 125, that's actually considered pre-diabetes. If you're at a 126 or above, that's where clinically we would say that you're a diabetic. And that's a danger zone, as we'll talk about in just a few seconds. Normal would be under 100. So ideal for your fasting blood sugar would be under 100 milligrams of glucose per deciliter of blood. And so 100 or less is good. Lower is better typically here. 100 to 125 is the pre-diabetes, getting into the close to the danger zone. 126 or higher is clinically considered type 2 diabetes. Now, you might be saying, okay, big deal. So I've got type 2 diabetes. Why is that an issue? That's an issue because this is one of the few diseases that damages multiple organ systems simultaneously. For instance, if you have high blood sugar, if you're clinically a diabetic, not only is your blood sugar high, but we're also damaging your kidneys in the process. We're damaging your vision. We're damaging your arteries. We're damaging the veins. We're damaging the heart itself. We're damaging the nervous system, we're damaging your brain. There are multiple organ systems that are basically destroyed as a result of this disease. Your risk of a fatal stroke and a fatal heart attack doubles when you're diabetic. So this is an incredibly serious disease that nobody should be dealing with. And we're going to talk tonight about how strength training can help you to avoid it, but we shared those numbers, and yes, we all need to be concerned about diabetes because it is an incredibly harmful disease. It affects multiple organ systems at the same time. So, having said that, I am preaching to the choir tonight. Everyone who's listening should already be living the strength train lifestyle. My goal here tonight is to reinforce your commitment to make it even stronger to stay with living that strength training lifestyle. So let's do things quickly tonight. Let's jump right in. How does strength training help you to keep your blood sugar healthy? Three basic ways. We're going to talk about how increasing muscle mass is important. We'll talk about how increasing muscle sensitivity to insulin is important and how strength training does that. And then how simply increasing your strength also helps you to avoid diabetes by keeping blood sugar healthy. So let's dive into number one here. One of the things that we all know through experience is that as we're aging, we start to lose skeletal muscle as we get older. And this shift occurs typically in our early to mid 30s. That rate of muscle loss, which is about a half a pound of muscle per year in our mid 30s, increases every decade of life. And so once we get past 50, if you're not strength training, you're losing about a pound of muscle per year, or 10 pounds in a decade. And again, into your 60s and 70s, that rate of muscle loss continues to accelerate. Why this is important is because skeletal muscle is the main tissue that stores glucose. So if you consume a meal and your blood sugar goes up, that glucose has a few places it can go. It can go to organs that need it for energy purposes, but then it gets stored in skeletal muscle. And so you want to view your muscles as the storage depots for glucose. And as the storage depots shrink and shrink and shrink, naturally, there's no place for that blood sugar to go other than simply stay in the blood and contribute to the development of high blood sugar and type 2 diabetes. So our goal here is to say we want to strength train because we want our muscle mass to be higher. And I'm not talking about being a professional bodybuilder, but I'm talking about preventing the normal loss of skeletal muscle that happens when we're not strength training as we age. And so the good news is here, we can reverse that muscle loss process immediately, and we can prevent it if we're strength training early enough in the life cycle. Now, if I were to ask Dr. Timothy Church, a renowned scientist at the Pennington Biomedical Research Center at Louisiana State University, he'll tell you that the biggest consumer of blood sugar in your body is skeletal muscle. His quote that he's known for is that if you keep your muscles happy, they chew up massive amounts of glucose. So again, the blood sugar has nowhere to go, or fewer places to go, when the storage tank shrinks. It ends up in your blood. We can help prevent that by keeping muscle mass larger and preventing the normal loss of muscle when you're not strength training. So simple but very direct way the strength train helps you to keep that blood sugar at a lower level is it keeps up total amount of muscle mass on your body. Number two, it helps to increase the muscle sensitivity to insulin. Now remember, type 2 diabetes is not the same as type 1. With type 1, you don't make insulin, and so you have to have intravenous insulin administered by someone else or yourself each day in order to avoid all kinds of catastrophic things. But with type 2 diabetes, your body does make insulin, and what happens is that your cell sensitivity to insulin goes down, so insulin basically doesn't work as well as it should with type 2 diabetes. So we now know that high-intensity exercise, like strength training, is a very effective way to maintain higher tissue sensitivity for insulin. When sensitivity is up, the insulin then works, so it pulls blood sugar out of the blood, puts it into the skeletal muscle, puts it into organs, puts it to use, basically, where it can be burned off and oxidized as a fuel source instead of, again, having it float around in the blood, becoming type 2 diabetic and damaging all those organ systems that I mentioned. So this is a very important distinction. It was 2005, a landmark study from a research group at McMaster University in Ontario, Canada, was published in the Journal of Applied Physiology, and they found that very intense 30-minute bursts of intense exercise repeated several times and done a couple times a week was very effective at developing all sorts of metabolic changes in the skeletal muscle that were positive from an insulin resistance standpoint. Now, that was 2005. Since then, many scientists have replicated that work and found that same outcome. So this is now known as what you'd call high-intensity interval training. But the thing that we should know about that is that strength training provides all the same benefits that high-intensity interval training provides, because what's happening here in your strength workout? You go 100% to muscle failure, very, very intense, very fatiguing to the skeletal muscle. You take a short break, you go to the next exercise, you do it again. So basically, minus the semantics, you're really practicing high-intensity interval training here when you're strength training, but we simply call it high-intensity strength training for a simplicity term. So that was 2005. We have a pretty growing body of evidence showing that intense, really intense exercise increases cell sensitivity to insulin and helps the insulin to work more effective, so it clears blood sugar from the blood. All right, very simple, but very relevant, very direct to what we're doing here. And then lastly, we know that strength training makes us stronger. Why this is important is because the largest study to date, published in the early 2000s in the journal The Lancet, found that adults who were pre-diabetic, if they just made a couple small changes in their lifestyle, one of those changes was to engage in brisk physical activity to the tune of about 20 minutes a day. Brisk physical activity, not sightseeing, not walking the dog, but getting outside and taking a brisk walk where your heart rate is elevated, where their breathing is more labored, but brisk physical activity, 20 minutes a day. These folks were 57% less likely to develop diabetes than a group that was given a common diabetes medication at that time. Now, I wrote about this in my article this month called The Blood Sugar Chronicle. So if you missed that, you can read that article at our Learning Center on our website. But this was the biggest study ever done on this, and we now have many diabetes prevention programs at medical centers around America using this protocol. But again, the take-home message is that those folks were doing 20 minutes a day of brisk physical activity, not strength training. And so the reason I'm saying that you need to strength train is that what happens as we're aging, of course, we get weaker. The weaker you get, the harder it is to engage in that level of physical activity, the less likely you are to engage in it. And so this is really a proactive step to say, okay, I've got to be active for the next 30 years. How am I going to do it? I need to have good muscular fitness so my functional strength is high, my muscular fitness is high. And so strength training is really the cornerstone so that you can then go live that active lifestyle that is good on a lot of different levels. In this case, preventing type 2 diabetes. 57% more effective than drug therapy at preventing the onset of type 2 diabetes in pre-diabetics. And so three to-dos here, right, are three ways that we're being benefited. More muscle mass, more storage area for glucose, higher sensitivity due to the metabolic adaptations in the skeletal muscle, and then more strength so we can go do the things, take the brisk walks, do the things we need to do long-term, not just for now, but long-term to prevent the development of type 2 diabetes. And so what should your workout look like? Again, I know I'm preaching to the choir. Two things you want to know about your workout here. You need to do a full body workout. Now, thankfully here at MEDFITNESS, we're doing a full body workout, but you don't want to miss any major muscles. You don't want to say, hey, I don't really like training my back, so I'm not going to do it. That's, again, remember, this is a storage depot. It's a lot of skeletal tissue, a lot of muscle tissue on your back. So we want to train your back. We want to train your shoulders, your biceps, your triceps, your trunk, your low back, your hips, your quadriceps, your hamstrings, everything. All of these are potential areas to build up for creating storage areas for glucose. And so we want to train our whole body, and we want each of those exercises to be equally hard. One of the worst things you can do is say, boy, this leg press was really hard, and then I like the next exercise because it's nice and easy. You're basically minimizing the benefit, and you're not getting the strength gain, you're not getting the increase in muscle mass, you're not getting the increase in muscle sensitivity when you work at a lower level of effort. So we're not suggesting that you have to kill yourself, but you do have to push yourself. This does need to be a high level of effort. Our recommendation is always to train close to or at muscle failure. And remember, guys, think about what you're dealing with here. You have a disease that will destroy your entire body systematically over time, or you can just tolerate a little bit of muscle burn a couple minutes, a couple times a week, and have all the benefits that life has to offer. So thank you for watching tonight. If you want to see this video and share it with friends and family, you can always go to our Learning Center. It'll be there in a couple weeks. That's medfitnessprogram.com/blog. Thanks for watching tonight.